Come to terms with who we have to know also the world that we live in. We have to know the Muslim community that we belong to, that we belong to here in the United States. And we have to also know the Muslim world. And I think that a lot of you, I would guess, like second generation Muslims throughout, immigrant Muslims throughout the United States, probably your education is essentially related to things like computers or to science, to medicine, which leads to a technological field. And of course, this is a good thing. This is what makes us a wealthy community. The Muslim community of the United States is the most wealthy Muslim community per capita in the world. As also, it is the most educated Muslim community per capita in the world. And, you know, the fact that we aren't doctors and lawyers and so forth, these are the kinds of things that you know, give us this tremendous economic power that we have potentially. But also, it's something that's very limited because of that these are not fields that enable us to understand us. And so it's also very important that we broaden out. And even if you're going to take a course of study, which is in computers or in science, it's really imperative also that you broaden it out and that you also get a background in sociology and psychology and history so that you understand the world in which we live. I spoke yesterday about the relationship of this community with the Muslim world, and I don't want to go back into that today, but one of the things that I would like to say is that when we speak to America, when we present Islam to America, we have to confront the sociological realities of the Muslim world. And we need to understand them very well. And we need to understand also how they affect us, how they work in our community. The phenomenon of fundamentalism and of fundamentalist activism in the modern Muslim world is a complex phenomenon. As Dr. Jackson has said, it is something that has much more to do with the psychology of the oppressed and the kind of personalities that are discussed in Princeton. I don't know if you know Princeton, the people of my age know very well. He wrote White Masks and Black Faces. He writes about the wretched of the earth and so forth. But the kind of psychological profile that we often confront in people like the people who killed Daniel Pearl or Mousavi and others. I mean, these are personalities that are taken out of the kind of studies that Prince Fanon did. And we need to understand that religion is a happening. People are in a very important part of that happening. The turmoil in the Muslim world today, the developments that are going on there, are very much a function of problems of urbanization, of rapid population growth, of the burgeoning cities and the young urban poor, the problems that we have of corruption, problems of underemployment and unemployment, and we need to understand that problem in a comprehensive way and face it. At various times during the presentations that have been given, it has been remarked that there are certain things that you can't do when you present this time to American people. But for example, if we insist that our religion is one that doesn't acknowledge any separation state, that, as Dr. Jackson said yesterday, immediately this is something that puts us out of the pale, beyond the pale with regard to Americans. There are other things also that have been mentioned. And one of the things that I would like to emphasize is that in the legacy of American attitudes towards religion that are informed by the experience that Europeans have with the church, with religious wars, with church oppression, that there are certain characteristics of the oppressive religious personality that have become stereotyped in the minds of Western people, Americans in particular. And just as we don't want to present ourselves as people who are anti-constitutional, unconstitutional, who would never recognize the basic structure of this country, so also we must not allow ourselves to fall in those categories. And to mention two of them, one is obscurantism, and the other is bigotry. These, in the history of the West, in the United States also, are the great contentions against religion and religious people, that religious people are obscurantists, that religious people are bigots. And as soon as we take those labels upon us, or as soon as we begin to behave in a way that confirms that suspicion, then we have totally lost credibility. And we have closed the doors for ourselves. And this is what I mean when I talk about knowing ourselves and speaking about ourselves honestly to the Americans and also to ourselves. Because that's what an obscurantist never does. And Dr. Matson mentioned the cartoons of the sheikh who is saying Islam is peace. And then in the background are the World Trade Centers. And then in the next one, he's saying Islam is peace. And in the background is the Pearl. And then he's saying Islam is peace, and then there's something else in the background. What is the purpose of that cartoon? To show that this man is obscurantist. That is what obscurantism is. The obscurantist is the one who never gives you the full story, who never faces the facts, who is always apologetic, who is always trying to put, you know, a spin on things, or to give things a nice, to sugarcoat them, to sanitize them. And in the history of the Western experience with religion, this is one of the faults of the religious personality, whether it be in a Catholic church that doesn't want to face up to sexual abuse, or in other things which makes them fundamentally defective. And one of the claims of the a-religious or the irreligious is that we are at least honest. We are not obscurantists. We face the facts as they are. And this is the way we must be. We must be people who are of the truth and for the truth, who speak the truth, even if it's against ourselves. And the social psychology of this country, that is to say, of the people in this country who are successful, namely the middle class, the upper classes, be they African American or white American, is one of problem solving, as opposed to the authoritarian mentality. The authoritarian mentality is always the loser in the modern world. And in the inner city where you have gangs, whether they be white or Hispanic or black or whatever, you have the authoritarian mentality. is notorious for not being able to recognize problems or solve them. But, you know, the problem solver has to see the problem. You know, we have to speak honestly about the way the Muslim world is. We have to analyze correctly where the problems come from also. I mean, to say, for example, that foreign policy is the only reason for our problems, that's obscurantism. It's patently false. Yes, foreign policy is part of the problem. Is it all the problem? And if you believe that, then obviously you've never lived in the Muslim world. You've never had to get a bribe. You've never had to, you know, live in the oppression and the utter disregard of human beings that all of us have seen who live there. So we have a lot of problems. We have infinite problems. You and I probably would never be able to solve those problems. One of the great benefits that we have in the United States is that we don't have to. And one of the things that the Sufis say is that if you have to choose between the companionship of an unbeliever who has good character or a believer who has bad character, whose companionship do you take? The unbeliever. Because the good character is transmitted and the bad character is transmitted, but faith and unbelief are not. So we live here in this society with people who are not perfect by any means. They are people who have drug problems and other problems that you know about as well. But nevertheless, the basic social psychology is healthy. It is a civilization. And, you know, the rights that I have here to be free, to assemble, freedom of speech, I can't tell you how priceless they are to me after having spent 19 years in different countries of the Muslim world where you have none of them. So, you know, we here have the ability to leapfrog over these social psychological problems of the Muslim world, which are so intricate and difficult to solve, and to start anew, to create a new binary star, not a black hole, and to build a Muslim society in this country. That's what we should be about. This is our obligation to do here. But in that process, we must be honest with ourselves. No, we must wean ourselves from the opium of rhetoric, the magic words, the good feeling. And we have to look at problems. And again, my compliment to you that every topic that has been spoken about in this conference has been meaningful. None of it, and if you look at other conferences, you'll see that often every topic that is spoken about is utterly meaningless. It's just feel good. And you know, this is not going to get us into it, but we must establish our credibility in this society. And again, as Quran said, that one of the secret to that is, first of all, to recognize the value of the American Constitution and to accept it and to acknowledge that there is nothing in that document which is antithetical to Islam. And when you accept it, you become American. You become accepted in this society. And you have a right to dissent. And when you do not accept it, you have none. And, you know, I myself, having been around legal scholars whom I regard as some of the best ones, I never found any of those legal scholars to say anything but the best about the American Constitution. The kind of rhetoric that we hear about it, that this is giving sovereignty of God to man, that is the words of fundamentalist activists, not of the Sahara, not of the Habib. They don't talk that way. They know what's good when they see it. So, you know, we must accept that. We must live in that. But we have to be people who have a discourse with ourselves, who are completely honest, and always remember this word, obscurantism. It Islamic experience, Jewish experience. You know, you can't have that label. And when we come forth and we don't grapple with the problem, I mean, there is such a thing as terrorism in the Muslim world. You know, we have big problems in the Muslim world. We have the people of France coming over. I've seen them myself. I know them. I know what they say. I know what they think. It is there, that problem. It's a minority. Thank God it's a minority, but it's there. And, you know, we need to understand that. And we need to deal with that. And we need to deal with every problem we face in a way that is honest and forthright, and that looks at both sides of the picture. And then you will be highly laudable in the society. This is not a disservice. This is what Allah says, speak the truth, do justice, even if it's against yourself. Another thing that I mentioned was religion. What is religion? What is religion? A hypocrite, all right. But that's not what a bigot is. A bigot is a special one. The bigot is the person who is clannish, who is tribalist, who is party oriented. Party spirit. The bigot knows his root, his interests, and that's it. Whatever is in his favor is right. Whatever is in their favor is wrong. So the bigot is the antithesis to the honest, objective, truth-seeking person who wants to open an honest discourse. And again, Muslims have shown themselves since September the 11th, in the eyes of Americans, often to be bigots. Why? Because of the fact that we don't accept anything that goes against us. We have a lot of rejectionists. We have a lot of denial. We have people that will not even accept to this day that Muslims committed the events of September the 11th. Wallahi, they did. And if you don't accept the evidence that they did, then, I mean, do you accept the evidence that you exist? Do you accept the evidence that there was a crusade? Do you accept the evidence that there was a First World War? I mean, how do we know anything? We have overwhelming evidence that supports that, nothing to the contrary. But we don't like it, so we don't accept it. And what we like, that's the bigot. And you remember the Serbian bigots, right? Because we said they were bigots. The Serbians who would say that there was no massacre in Bosnia, or the Bosnians massacred themselves. And we would sit and we would grind our teeth when we looked at them on the television and say, what is wrong with these people? But then comes September 11th, and here at Muslims, I was on a television program, public television in Chicago, with a Palestinian, God bless him. And you know, he begins, he opens up, this is like maybe September, I don't know if it was 18th or something. He begins by saying that Muslims could have never committed September the 11th because a Muslim just couldn't do that. You know, take an airplane with innocent people on it, fly it into a building. No Muslim could do that. Okay.